As you heard earlier, the city of Davis is proud to be a partner with AEG Sports and being named as a host city for the Tour of California. So those of you have told me that next to being married and the birth of their kids, a ride along with a grand tour event is one of the greatest days of your life. And we have the opportunity that you can actually keep the house lights up, please, so we can see people bidding. Keep the house lights up. We're going to be having an auction so you can buy a ride. You can buy a ride inside of the package, the entire ride along of the Davis Stage 2 to Santa Rosa inside the security perimeter to see how AEG Sports, how Medalist Sports run a grand tour event. We have some people in the room tonight. Beth Lovering and Norbert Wagner have done this, and Dennis Lindsay. They have told me it is a phenomenal experience, and you just have to bid on it tonight, and it could be yours. So what we'd like to do is consider this. I think last year, Tom Lovering bought it for Beth for her birthday or something like that. And is that right? They're back there. We're going to have bidding starting at $500. The proceeds from this will help our local organizing committee so we can properly host a world-class event, the Amgen Tour of California 2010, May 17th on a Monday morning from Davis to Santa Rosa. So all you need to do is raise your hands, and we're going to bid this thing up, and it'll support our efforts in Davis to bring Lance and Levi and AEG and all the riders to Davis for a second year in a row. So hopefully we have some people out here. They're interested because this is a great once-in-a-lifetime experience. So what do I hear? Do I hear a $500 bid? $500 bid for the ride-along. There's the $500 right there. $600. $600. Do I see? Six right here. Six. Do I hear seven? I've got $600 right here. This is worth a couple thousand dollars, folks. I have a $600 bid. Do I hear seven? There's seven right there. Right there. Yes, I see. Okay. Yeah. Does he know he's bidding on it yet? No. $600. Come on, folks. Do I hear $650? There's $650 right there. Do I hear seven? Do I hear seven? Seven right there. $750. I see seven right there. $750 right there. Do I hear eight? $750. Do I hear eight? Stand up, folks. $750. There it is. There it is. There's eight right there. Okay. There's $800. $850. Okay. $800. $800. Do I hear $850? Somebody stand up quickly. There it is right there. Okay. That's $850. Nine. $850 is on the table. $850 right there. Do I hear nine? $900 right there. Do I hear $950? $900 is the bid. $950. $900. $950 right there. Do I hear $1,000? $1,000. $950 is a bid. There's $1,000 right there. Okay. We've broken the $1,000 mark. Okay. All right. $1,050. $1,050. $1,000. Going once? Okay. There's $1,050 right there. Will you match it? Will you match it? What do we have? We have $1,050 right there. And we're matching right there. Stand up. Both of you stand up, please. Stand up. Stand up. Okay. I've got $1,050 there and $1,050 over here, right? Okay. There we go. Okay. What's your bid? $1,100. Will you match it? Okay. You're going up? $1,200? What's that? $1,150. $1,150? $1,200. Will you match it? $1,200. What's he at? $1,500? Tom, stand up. Stand up. $1,500. Going once. $1,500. You're sure you don't want $1,500 over here? Okay. Steven, is that you over there? $1,500? What if I make you a deal? If both of you kick in $1,500, I'll get another ride for you. Are you on? No? 16? 16? 16? Steve.
16, and I'll 16.50 for both of you, and I'll give you each a signed 2010 Leaders jersey. 16 each. Sold? 16. Each of you get the ride, and each of you will get a 2010 signed Leaders jersey from whoever wins it.
There it is. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. That was Andrew Messick, president of AEG Sports. $1,650. Andrew Messick went to UC Davis. His last final was 86. This is the first day he's been back to Davis. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, Andrew. We'll settle up later. Michael, back to you.
All right, that worked out well. Andrew Messick, thank you so much for your support. AEG is the organization that owns and executes the Tour of California, this hugely complex venture. Andrew runs the entire department for AEG Sports. This is one of the great races in the world, ladies and gentlemen. We're so proud to have it here in Davis. Next year, stage two starts right here. It goes on to Santa Rosa. It was so much fun during our little break here watching Phyllis down here hold court, cyclist down there talking gears with her and seat posts, and doesn't matter, 93, she'll talk anything with you about bicycle riding. What an amazing lady. It was such a treat to watch her up here a little while ago. And on we go to our next inductee. But before we do that, I have actually my own announcement to make. Last night I was telling Richard Brine down here a little bit about, he actually escorted us through the Bicycle Museum, and we were talking, and a light bulb went on in my head that I knew about a bike that was sitting somewhere that actually could end up in the museum, and I scored it for you, so we're going to have it soon. It is a 1985 bike written by the five-time winner of the Tour de France, Bernard Hinault. In the Tour de France, he rode it on the flats, and immediately following the race, he turned the bike over to the guy who ran CBS's coverage of the event, David Michaels, and David will loan it to us permanently from his personal collection. So there we go. It's good. David was off covering the Notre Dame game. He is the director for NBC now, and he handles the opening and closing ceremonies for the Olympic Games. So he's still at it. When I say handles, he is the executive director of those two events for NBC. Next up, we are going to have our induction for Clayton John, famous for off-road and BMX and cyclocross and mountain biking. He was very instrumental in the very beginning stages, as was Phyllis, of the whole world of bicycle motocross. And making the presentation is a guy who's been outbid by Toby Henderson for the Hank Aaron Ball, which I think is up to 560, something like that, but he may come back. Would you please welcome to the stage the son of the former inductee, Bernie Anderson, from the class of 2007, B.A. Anderson, as he will be inducting Clayton John into the class of 2009.
When Clayton John opened his bike shop in State College, Pennsylvania in 1972, he offered the local kids an opportunity to race each other on a dirt track near his store. John's new race format combined the physical demands of cycling with the thrill of motocross. It was bicycle motocross. The Eastern United States was about to learn the meaning of BMX. In the 30 years that followed, Clayton John not only watched BMX grow into one of the most popular youth sports in America, he fostered its growth. dedicating himself to the development of the sport and the development of athletes who dreamed of racing bikes in the dirt. His racetrack in Pennsylvania would become the first track in the eastern U.S. to be certified by the American Bicycle Association. John went on to build numerous BMX tracks between 1982 and 1985, while also building the infrastructure of the sport, including many of the rules that remain in effect today. But John made more than tracks and rules. He helped make professional BMX riders too by creating the sport's first contingency program to help pro riders earn a living. And to help riders at every level, John also created Goldline Incorporated, a supplier of BMX specialty equipment popular at bike shops and races nationwide. A former vice president and president of the American Bicycle Association, John also served as the ABA National Race Series Director and helped stage more than 30 national BMX events in the United States and Canada. Visionary, promoter, businessman, and advocate, over the course of more than 30 years, Clayton John lit the torch for BMX and helped fuel the flame all the way to Beijing, where in 2008, BMX made its debut as an Olympic sport. John's legacy in the sport of BMX continues to burn brightly.
Just to clear a few things up, cyclocross, not really. We'd never really had anything to do with cyclocross. Clayton, BMX has been in his blood since the very beginning. We did touch into mountain biking a little bit, or Clayton did with Norba. The ABA at one point owned Norba, which we eventually sold to USCF. And not really sure exactly what the year was. I was still a racer at that point, but it was about 87, 89, I think, is when that happened. But for the record, the bid on the Hank Aaron Ball is 700. And I just wanted to let you know, my name is Bernard Anderson. As Michael said, my father, Bernie Anderson, was inducted in 2007. And Clayton John has been the president for 27 years of the American Bicycle Association. I mean, there is nobody in the sport of BMX that has contributed more as far as the promotion and just the advancement of the sport of BMX all the way to the 2008 Olympics, where, of course, we had a silver and a bronze in the men and a bronze in the women, all ABA, past ABA champions. So we're very proud of that. Clayton is very proud of that. He was there to witness that. I've had the pleasure of working with Clayton for the past 16 years at the ABA. And after 27 years, Clayton retired this past year in 2008. And I mean, it's been one of the best things that's ever happened to me. I mean, I've had the good fortune of stepping into his shoes as the new CEO of the ABA. This is both good and bad. It's some big shoes to fill, and it's not going to be an easy task, believe me. But I don't think anyone, Clayton included, would ever want to be held accountable for every decision they've ever made. But my only hopes in filling Clayton's shoes is that the decisions I make in the future would be the same decisions that Clayton would have made as a CEO. He's been that great for the sport, and that's all I could hope for. I mean, there were races and meetings that Clayton and I attended together where, I mean, just sitting in the meeting, things Clayton would say, I'd think to myself, oh my gosh, this guy is so good. I don't know if we could ever find anybody to replace him. I mean, just some of the things that he's done for the sport and said. I think there's some of the members, Hall of Fame members here in the audience could attest to some of the things Clayton has done
in that respect. But, I mean, Clayton has always been a gracious leader and an educator, and I'm just thankful that over the last 16 years that Clayton has been so forthcoming in passing along his knowledge to me and other staff members of the ABA so we can continue that legacy. Clayton started his BMX career in the early 70s, as the slideshow said, as a parent of a BMX racer. He then went on to, you know, open his own bike shop in State College, Pennsylvania. He was also the coach of the Penn State cycling team in Pennsylvania. He started his own BMX track in Pennsylvania, State College, Pennsylvania, which hosted several, you know, ABA national events. In 1981 is when Clayton made his move to Arizona, which started his real career in basically guiding the sport of BMX. Clayton not only promoted BMX races, though, back in Pennsylvania. I mean, he was a motorcycle promoter, a motorcycle racer. I'm sure his bones can attest to that, too. He also promoted Norba races. Like I was mentioning earlier, at one point, Clayton may tell the story, I'm not sure, but somebody had approached Clayton about taking over Norba. I'll let him tell the story if he wants to tell that story, but it was a, basically, we, the ABA, not we, I was not involved at that time, I was still a racer, but Clayton did foster the growth of mountain biking long before USCF and any of that, and then we did eventually sell Norba to USCF. Any hockey fans? He was actually a Penn State hockey coach long before his BMX career as well. And one thing about Clayton that is just amazing, and I can only hope to obtain this ability one day, but I mean, Clayton, as the leader of the ABA, I mean, he had an unbelievable ability to calm a situation. I mean, as the promoter of BMX and the governing body rules maker of the sport, I mean, we were often faced with situations where we were, well, more often than not, disqualifying riders as you know, officials. And the kids we were disqualifying, they're, you know, anywhere from the age of 5 to 65, so we did have some irate parents that were there that obviously didn't believe that they should have been disqualified, and the parents were there attesting to the fact that that's not what happened. And Clayton always had the ability to talk to these people, and more often than not, they would walk away wondering, why do I feel so happy after just being disqualified? And they would walk away with a smile on their face, and by that time they were already in the car headed home, so it worked out great for us. So I never understood that. I mean, they'd come to the window yelling and screaming, and by the time they left, thought it was the greatest thing that ever happened to them. Clayton's had an extremely successful career in BMX, which is actually his second career, like I said. Before his BMX career, he was actually the coach for the Penn State hockey team, like I said, and as well as the cycling team. But as the hockey coach, Clayton took them to 2 consecutive national championships. And for that accomplishment, he's actually in the Penn State Hall of Fame as well. So, and I believe that happened in 1992. So this is actually Clayton's second Hall of Fame that he has been inducted into. So as you can see, everything he's done has been over the top his entire life. So there's nobody more deserving. Not only is Clayton a member of both these Hall of Fames, he was also the founder of a Hall of Fame. With my father, Bernie Anderson, the 2007 inductee into the Bicycling Hall of Fame and the owner of the ABA, they actually together founded the ABA BMX Hall of Fame, which we just moved the BMX Hall of Fame from our offices in Chandler, Arizona, which was really a hallway that headed to the restroom to the right. But it's actually now housed in the Chula Vista Olympic Training Center in Southern California. And that is just a great accomplishment for the sport of BMX. And, you know, obviously this is the pinnacle of all Hall of Fames as far as cycling, and it's great that Clayton's being recognized for this, as well as some of the other members that are here tonight from the sport of BMX. So, I don't want to take all of your time. I had at least an hour and 3 minute speech, but I wanted to slow down just a little bit. But so, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the hundreds of thousands of BMX racers all across the country, all of the past BMX track operators and track managers all around the country, past and present ABA, BMX employees that Clayton has influenced, sorry, I would like to introduce you to the 2009 U.S. Bicycling Hall of Fame inductee, Clayton John.
Thank you. Thank you, BA. Just for your knowledge, the baseball is at $1,200. I told him he'd go to $2,000, not to worry about it. Okay. He got a little overboard there. I had no notes originally, and I figured I've done this 100 times. I've done seminars with BMX track operators all over the country. So what's the big deal? Well, I started getting a little bit nervous when I came in the door today, and I said, well, wait a minute, this is a lot different than what I've been at. Plus, I don't know about half of the, or probably 90% of the people here. So just to make me feel better, I'd like to have Sherry Elliott, Stu Thompson, and Toby Henderson, BMXers at heart. Would you please stand up? You're in the Hall of Fame. Okay, can you give them a hand? Thank you. Thank you. Now I feel at home, okay? You know, it's crazy the way things evolved and what happened. I'll just try to give you a little short story about my life and how everything evolved. First off, I want to thank the United States Bicycling Hall of Fame for the fantastic job they've done here, and also the California Bicycle Hall of Fame for joining together, which is probably the hardest thing two organizations can ever have to do, is to come together for one common cause. But it's fantastic to see the development and how it's been enriched by the city of Davis giving the facility and everything they've done to make everybody here feel so welcome. And not only that, I haven't seen as many bicycles on the road since I left Penn State, State College, Pennsylvania, back in the 80s, and it's fantastic to see. It's a great job they've done here. And so I wanted to make sure that everybody there, and also the city of Davis, everything they've done to make sure that we have a home here for the future. And I wanted to thank all of them. It all started back with me. First let me get to the real important part, okay? My foundation is my wife, Lorraine. Hon, would you stand up? In 1958, she said, okay, I'll put up with you for a while. 51 years later, she's still putting up with me, so it's fantastic. My two daughters, Jennifer and Mara, the whole thing is about family. BMX is a family sport. Most of cycling is a family sport, but BMX is really where the rubber meets the road, okay? That's the beginning. That's where you either are involved in the sport or you're not involved in the sport. And my two daughters have been fantastic, and couldn't have got anywhere or done anything that I've done without the support of them. My son, who couldn't be here, was the one who got me started into BMX. I had a motorcycle, motocross background and really loved that sport. Got promoted through the Columbia Gas Company, which I worked for from a young age all the way until the 70s. Moved to state, got promoted and moved to state college. In those days, it's amazing. You used to get promoted. They'd give you a title. They'd move you to a new area. You never got a dime more. I don't understand that, but you know, you were really moving up. But anyway, we moved to State College, Pennsylvania, and worked there. And we ended up, my wife and I, we ended up deciding we were going to buy a billiard room. It's a pool hall normally, but in State College, it was a billiard room, we called it. And we went into business with that, and things were going good, and I was still working at Columbia Gas. And we went out in November to buy a bicycle for my oldest daughter, Jennifer, and for Christmas. Went to the swing shop and figured we're buying her this 3-speed, and by gosh, this is the one we want. And he told us, well, I can't have it for Christmas. So needless to say, we were disappointed. We ended up buying something from a store. I don't even remember which one. It was a Kmart or something, I don't know, at the time, just to put something under the tree. But my wife said, that does it. This town needs another bike shop. So I said, really? And she says, yes, we do. And so I started researching it a little bit. And as time went on, the next thing you know, we were getting involved in a bicycle shop and opened it in 1972. And we called it John's Derailleurs. What a name. Nobody knew what derailleur meant, but we had it. Big sign, okay? We're right there on the main drag in town, and boy, we were really doing great. Had a super following, had a bunch of kids that worked for us, all our son's friends, and they became mechanics, and we opened a big mechanical shop there, and I'd always been involved in sports of all kinds, basically, and really had a love for hockey, and was coaching my son's hockey team in school, high school, and decided that we were going to get a few sporting goods things at the shop. So as time went on, no matter what it was, somebody walked in the door, they wanted either a field hockey stick and the ball, which nobody in town had. Well, we'd buy them and we'd put them in. So we became a bicycle shop / sporting goods store / repair shop for quite a few years there. And that sort of led to other things, but I've been a workaholic all my life, so I couldn't just have two businesses we were running. I decided I was going to take over the motocross track that was out in Stormstown, and so I ran that for about 4 years, and my son, in running that track, my son came one day to me and said, look, Dad, he says, look at this. They got bicycles on a track, and he said, you can do that. I know you can. Well, yeah, I know you can. So this place was 13 miles from town, and the town of Stormstown probably had about 800 people living there. There were only 35,000 people in State College at the time. And so we figured, okay, we'll give it a try. Well, that led to a BMX track, led to John's Derailleurs BMX racing, and it just kept going and going. So we get to the 80s, and we were an ABA track, one of the first ones east of the Mississippi. We joined the American Bicycle Association at the time. They came into being in 1977, and I had a fella called Gene Roden who came out and talked to me about signing up with them. They had a national organization. I didn't really know whether they did or not, but he sure gave me a good spiel. So we bought into it, and the thing that attracted me was I was paying $25 for insurance at that time for that race, where before I was paying $150 for the motocross insurance to cover the bicycle race. So I saved quite a bit of money to start with. But anyway, went into that. We ended up having all kind of, I'd say, success in the BMX industry at that time. It was brand new. Anybody that had a track flourished, and if you ran it right. And so here we are. I'm coaching Penn State varsity hockey team, and it gets into January, and the ABA has a seminar that's going on in Vegas. And I'm in a tournament, so I can't go. So my wife, who, thank goodness, doesn't gamble at all, hates it, she went to Vegas to take care of everything for us there and represent us at the seminar. So she meets a couple in Vegas, and they are from Phoenix, and they said, come on. Come down to Phoenix, you can fly out there just as easy as you can from here. So now we're talking January 1981, okay? And here we go. She flies home in January, probably 2 foot of slush and frozen rain and snow, and cold as the dickens, but that's what it always was back in central Pennsylvania in the mountains. And all I hear about is Phoenix, Arizona. My gosh, what a place that is. So here's a lady who's been with me all these years, never asked for a thing, stood by my side, shored me up when I needed help, and never asked for a thing. And what have I got to do? I said, okay. May comes along with spring break. I come home, throw two tickets on the table, and say, we're going to go to Phoenix and see what's so great about Phoenix, Arizona. Well, it impressed me because the third day there, we bought a home. I fly home, and my three children at home think I've lost my mind. They want to have me committed. I must be crazy. I've got two businesses going in town, and I'm trying to leave. Needless to say, everything went well. We moved to Arizona, get to Arizona, and when I was there and bought the home, I called quite a few of the bike suppliers because I figured I'd start a bike shop when I got to Arizona. And they said, oh, that's fine, no problem. So I get to Arizona, and see, you have to understand, State College, Pennsylvania, it's a little town, nothing around it, Penn State University, that's all, and a downtown. Well, I go to Arizona, and when I finally realized when I got there, there's a downtown every square mile. Where do you put a bike shop? How can you afford to promote a bike shop and in a place like that? So it was driving me crazy. I ended up going around. Finally, my wife said, go talk to Merle. He was the one that owned ABA at the time. And she says, go talk to him. He's been here for a long time. So I went to talk to him. Told me to go to Chandler and put the shop there. Went there. It was nothing but drunken Indians in 1981, laying in the gutters with brown paper bags. So I figured that was a bad move. Anyway, I went back the second time, and he said, come here. I'm trying to start a Total Marketing Systems, where we're going to go contact all the bike shops in the country. It's going to be a phone system. Why don't you help me get started with that? And then by then, you'll feel at home, and you'll know what you want to do. So I went to work for him at that time, got that thing started, and then that eventually evolved into me being there. And in 1985, after I'd been promoted to Vice President of Marketing, which, again, no raise, but Bernie Anderson comes in, and unbeknownst to me, I was only Vice President of Marketing. I didn't know what the finances were, but we were in deep doo-doo. And here he comes in and buys the company, and it's going to set us straight, and the next thing you know, we put a gentleman in as president. And once, I guess, in about June or July, he figured out that all he wanted to do was have his feet on the desk. So he said, how about you taking over as president? And I took over, I believe, in July, if I'm not mistaken, Bernie. And I was president from July of 85 until 2008 when I retired. It was fantastic. It's the greatest job anyone, anywhere could ever want. I mean, I had a job where I couldn't wait to get up in the morning to get to work. And working with the youth kept me so invigorated with cycling and getting the message out to people that it became almost impossible to control myself. It sometimes Bernie would have to reel me in and say, what are you thinking? We have to pay for some of this stuff. So we'd back up a little bit, but he'd always give me enough rein to get out there and stir things up and get things going. We had trouble when he first bought it. We were down to under 100 tracks in the United States, and we had at one time 400 tracks, and we got down to 100, and we came up with this crazy idea. Well, you know, when everybody thinks you're down and out, and you don't have a chance, and you're going to go out of business, let's do something that really blows their mind. So we took the entire staff. We put a national in Hawaii and took the entire staff to Hawaii. We ended up there with like 38 motos. I don't know whether you were there, Toby, or not, but all we had to do was get the race done. Everybody wanted to go to the beach. They didn't care about the BMX race. But it was the greatest thing because all of a sudden everybody said, now they can't be going out of business. Look what they're doing. Look how much money they've spent. Well, a lot of it was on two credit cards, Bernie's and mine, and whatever else we could do. But that's okay because it worked. And went through all this. We got up to the point where we're running over 10,000 races a year with sanctioning. And we always ran about 27, 28 nationals events a year. I never missed a one until, I don't remember, one time in, I think it was 93 or 94, they wanted me to go to Ohio and meet with the NBL board and talk to them about what could improve BMX for them. And I took the day off from the Sunday race in El Paso to go. That was the first race I'd ever missed. And after that, I just relaxed a little bit and started biding my time. The beginning of 2008, I'll make this shorter. The beginning of 2008, when my wife asked me, by then I'm 69, going to be 70 in February, and she said, we've had all this time. She said, when is it going to be our time, yours and mine? Well, you talk about sucker punching, that right in the gut, okay? So I said, all right, that's it. So I go in and I tell them, okay, this is it. End of the year, I'm out of here. Well, for about 6 months, I don't think I even slept very good. I couldn't grasp the fact that I was getting out of something that was my life. And by the time October rolled around, I was saying, okay, let's get it over with. Well, at the Grands, they inducted me into the ABA Hall of Fame, which we started in 1985. And instead of a watch, which he already got me a watch years ago, they gave me a 34 Ford, three-window coupe, which I'd wanted all my life. And I went away one of the happiest guys in town. I'm staying on as a consultant as long as they'll keep me, and as long as I can keep my hands in BMX and keep contact with track operators all across the country and just whatever it takes that I can do to help the sport, I'm there. Thanks very much. I appreciate it.
Clayton John. Boy, you talk about entrepreneurial spirit, that's it right there. Well, we have one final inductee tonight. And first I want to mention that the Hank Aaron ball is up to $700. Nice. So that is true. Now listen to this. This is a guy who, other than Barry Bonds, had more home runs than anybody in all of baseball, 775 of those, 6,856 total bases, and 2,291 RBIs. Anyway, one of the coolest cats in the whole world. He had a 97.3 induction vote the first year he was eligible for the Hall of Fame of baseball and the other Hall of Fame, and it was absolutely the highest anybody had ever gotten. I just want to know who that 2.17% was that didn't vote for Hank Aaron. Who knows? But anyway, he's 75 years old now, by the way, and $700 is where we're at. The Felt Cruiser is up to $400. The Cavendish Herbalife jersey, $410. We're doing well. We will close this 10 minutes after tonight's program. Well, we're going to do something rather strange now, and that is we're going to have a presenter for a presenter. Normally I would do that, but tonight I'm bestowing the honor on to a great friend, Todd Gogulski. Also, we will escalate up in our overall fashion sense as we move through that, starting with me. Todd, I told not to wear a tie because I knew that Gorski was going to wear a tie and look very businessy as he usually does. But then it goes to Nelson Vales, who's not only entering the Hall of Fame here, but the Hall of Fame of one of the best dressed guys in the whole planet. And he did it up tonight, as only Nelly can. Todd Gogulski, former U.S. national champion, raced on team at a different time with both Greg LeMond and Lance Armstrong, which is very cool. He spent a lot of time in the sport doing lots of things, and then just recently became the sports commentator, the TV commentator for the Tour of Italy on Universal Sports NBC, and for the Tour of Spain, Basque Country, and will be doing exactly the same thing ad infinitum for a long time down the road. And, by the way, just moved to Davis. UC Davis is now the home for his wife, who just got an extraordinary job here with tenure, never having been at the university, if you can imagine that. An extraordinary achievement that is. Todd is along for the ride. He is here, and he will introduce Mark Gorski tonight. So here comes my friend, Todd Gogulski.
Good evening, everybody, and I have to say that it's really a pleasure to be here. I've only been in town since the beginning of October, and I moved here at the end of September, but immediately left for a TV job, and it's been a terrific time here, just in the little bit of time I've been here, and the energy I've seen over the last week, and especially the last couple days, building here for this great Hall of Fame has been terrific. But the next speaker, who will be inducting this year's final new member of the U.S. Bicycling Hall of Fame, is a cyclist who, back in 1978, was part of the formidable first group of athletes, along with the hockey team, believe it or not, at the newly established Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Two of the other notable cyclists at that center that year included Greg LeMond, the first American to win the Tour de France, and Connie Carpenter-Finney, who will be our keynote speaker here later this evening, who won the first Olympics road race for women back in 1984 in Los Angeles. He's a gold medalist from the 1984 Los Angeles Olympic Games. He's also a five-time national champion. He's a Pan American Games silver medalist in 1987, and his racing career spanned 16 years from 1974 to 1989. He was inducted into the Hall of Fame in 1995, and after he got out of racing, he became the CEO and general manager of the U.S. Postal Team from 1995 to 2003. That was the first and really the only team with its name changed later to Discovery Channel that has ever produced from the United States a winner of the Tour de France. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in just a moment, please welcome Mark Gorski, and he will introduce Nelson Vales. Thank you.
From the concrete jungle of Harlem, New York, to the podium of the Olympic Games, Nelson Vales rode his bicycle further than anyone would have thought possible. The great Harlem poet Claude Brown once wrote, "Despite everything Harlem did to our generation, I think it gave something to a few. It gave them a strength that couldn't be found anywhere else." Harlem gave Nelson Vales the strength to overcome anything or anybody that stood between him and his destiny of becoming one of America's greatest cyclists. The youngest of 10 children, Vales earned a living and a reputation as a bicycle messenger in New York City. One announcer dubbed him the Cheetah, and whether he was racing to deliver a package or to beat fellow competitors around Central Park, Vales always seemed to finish first. He took home a gold medal from the 1983 Pan American Games, but his greatest first came in 1984, when Vales became the first African American cyclist to win an Olympic medal. At the 1984 Olympic Games in Los Angeles, Vales took home the silver in the track sprint behind fellow American Mark Gorski. Vales was also the 1984 national sprint champion and national tandem sprint champion in 1984, 1985, and 1986. In 1985, he earned a silver medal in the tandem sprint at the World Championships. And like so many of the great cultural icons that came out of Harlem during the past century, Vales even took his talents to the silver screen, starring in the film Quicksilver, along with Kevin Bacon, which told the story of bike messengers in New York City. Against the odds, Nelson Vales prevailed.
Thank you. First of all, let me be brief tonight. We don't have time for a third intermission, and we are not even yet to our keynote speaker, Connie Carpenter Finney. So I'm going to try and do this quickly. We have some great video that Nelson's going to narrate here shortly. It's really an honor for me to be here tonight to pay tribute to my friend and longtime rival, competitor, and teammate, along with a lot of other friends here in the audience, Connie Paris, Kevin Young, Sheila Young-Akowitz, Connie Carpenter Finney, and Paul Swift, others who spent a lot of time training with Nelson and are here to really support his induction tonight. I also want to thank and acknowledge the many years of support and enthusiasm that a number of key people associated with the Hall of Fame have provided, Ernie Subert, Peter DeHaan, Ray Cipollini, who was mentioned earlier. Their passion for the Hall of Fame and the heritage of the sport has meant a lot to all U.S. cyclists. Okay, so for those of you who are too young or not able to witness Nelson racing in person, you missed a great show. And unfortunately, the reruns are not in syndication. You get to see a little bit about it, a little bit of the action tonight. But quite simply, Nelson was and is one of the most memorable cyclists in U.S. history. He was hugely entertaining, a tremendous athlete, and is well remembered by anyone who saw him in person. Over the years, for me, and being a huge sports fan that I am, when I describe cycling to friends or journalists or sponsors, I always tend to use sports analogies. And in my mind, Nelson was equal parts Wilt Chamberlain, Muhammad Ali, and Magic Johnson. He was a true pioneer. He brashly told the world his intentions, and he had a smile that made everyone around him feel great. As all of you know, Nelson and I were match sprinters, a totally different breed of cyclists. Of course, match sprinting is a totally different sport than road racing or the Tour de France, which many of you are primarily familiar with in cycling. Really, match sprinting is the explosiveness of the 100-meter dash. It's the aggression and tactics of NASCAR. And it's the hype and the head games of a heavyweight title fight in boxing. And Nelson and I went head-to-head over many years at the U.S. National Championships, the Olympic Trials, Grand Prix events around the world, and ultimately at the Olympic Games. And in the early years, Nelson went from being a curiosity with long dreadlocks, his yellow and green jersey, and a colorful entourage out of New York City. In time, though, he became Nelson the Cheetah Vales, the fastest cat in the jungle. With 29-inch thighs, he had the skyline of New York City custom painted on his bright red helmet, and he really had the fastest acceleration in the world from 0 to 44 miles an hour. I was in awe of the athleticism, and I was truly entertained by the show, just like everybody else. So when we did meet for the gold medal on August 3rd of 1984, it created a very intriguing matchup. The contrast between us was stark. First of all, no one ever called me the fastest cat in the jungle. I had to rely on experience and top-end speed to negate Nelson's explosiveness. And what I really remember, and I've shared this with many people over the years, is that Nelson and I really exchanged no words for many days leading up to the Olympic final when we faced each other. I think we both knew that our dreams of achievement meant a showdown against each other, and that our friendship would have to be set aside as we prepared for that big moment. Anyway, you all know what happened on that day on August 3rd. You'll see what happened on the videos to follow, and it forever linked Nelson and I. And throughout all these years as competitors, Nelson and I became great friends. We traveled as teammates, roommates on many European road trips and to many international competitions. And I can tell you as an eyewitness that Nelson's love of life cannot be overstated. I thought about trying to tell all of you just one of the outrageous, sort of unbelievable stories of Nelson's off-the-bike escapades. And then I thought, you simply wouldn't believe it. I mean, how could you possibly believe, and I want Nelson to clue in on these, how could you possibly believe shooting bottle rockets into Moscow's Red Square on the 4th of July with armed guards scurrying around looking for the culprits? Or a spontaneous full-tackle football game between Team USA and Team East Germany on a city square in Armenia. Parties, discos, and good times around the world. Through all this, Nelson made people smile and laugh, and through his electrifying speed and talent on the bike, he entertained them all. Ultimately, though, the story of Nelson is about an ambitious young kid from Harlem, one of 10, who never stopped believing in himself and who never put limitations on his dreams. Seeing the look on Nelson's face as he traveled up Broadway, remember this, Nelson? During the ticker tape parade for all the Olympic medalists in New York City, I realized the significance of his personal journey to the top of the cycling world. He was beaming with pride. I have great respect and admiration for my friend Nelson, and I'm so proud of him for his recognition. Thank you.
Thank you. Hold the video for a second. That was deep. That was real deep. Mark forgot to mention about some of the Moscow nights at midnight in Gorky Park with vodka and orange juice, being chased by dogs, police dogs. Usually I run from the police. From my background. Before you start the video, once again, thank you. Thank you to the Hall of Fame and all the inductees and everyone that's here to share this moment with us all. I'd like to change from how I got here to how we got here, because there's no I in team. Go ahead and roll the tape.
Nelson Vales is the youngest of 10 children and a devoted father himself at the age of 16. At the 1984 Los Angeles Olympics, fellow American Mark Gorski is his opponent in the sprint final. Vales began cycling seriously while working as a New York City bike messenger. At night, he trained in Central Park. Nelson Vales wins the silver and becomes the first African American to earn a cycling medal.
Was touching. It's like, throw some tears at me. I tell you, you see the pictures now from Toga Bike Shop. That was the true beginning of being discovered by Lenny Preheim. The story is of from being a messenger in New York City, I was always a bike racer riding around Central Park because it was in my backyard, having my first bicycle at 6 years old. And from the beginning, and as we get going here from these early photos, I'd like to thank my sister Deborah and her husband James, and my niece Julie, who's here tonight. They've been here since the beginning of the first pedal stroke. So thank you, family, for being here with me to share this moment. You know, the Cinderella story of being a bicycle messenger to go on and win an Olympic medal, it is a myth, but it is true. I was always racing and training at night in Central Park and working during the day to support my family, fathering my first kid at the age of 16, and then having my second daughter 4 years later, and now I'm a grandparent. It's pretty cool, I look pretty good, don't I? But I was always a bike messenger in New York City, and just real quick, I was gonna just take you for a ride through New York City and how I named my nickname the Cheetah. So just follow me along here just a little bit as I flow through New York City. And if you ever go for a bike ride with me and I ride in the middle of the street, which Connie can contest, I have no problem riding in traffic because I'm not afraid, and you just have to go around or run me over. So that's how I roll when I roll in the streets. So if I ever riding around Davis, yeah, if I go out of the bike lane, it's just natural that I just happen to roll out of the bike lane, so everybody has to wait until I pass. But things like this is the fun part of my life. It helped my bike handling skills and my travel around the world, and my fear of making my way into the sport of cycling. It was just a fun thing to do. You know, things like this, let's go ahead and cut the sound because I'll get confused between this and something like Ray-Ban commercial that I don't think Mark haven't even seen, but thanks to Mark Gorski and Steve Disson at ProServe, I was able to gain a sponsorship along with Mark with Ray-Ban and having my own line of sunglasses along with Connie. We shared those photos as well, Connie Perskevin, so she's here tonight as well. But sold more of those glasses in Italy than we did in America, but between Norm and the sponsorship, that was a pretty good buck to be an amateur. You know, I would like to call myself a professional amateur back in those days. What you're looking at now, and I'm gonna try to again stay with the program here. Back in 1988, Mark and I competed for the 88 Olympic team, and I didn't make it. Mark was an alternate, so the next day I turned professional and left to Belgium to live with a Belgian family and started my pro cycling career. Everyone actually congratulated me and thanked me, but then they were sorry as well because I didn't make the Olympic team, but now I was a professional and I was gonna live the life of a professional on the road in Europe. And back in those days, these accomplishments became because you only had the 7-Eleven team in Europe and you had Nelson Vales and you had Greg LeMond. Greg LeMond and I was the most photographed athletes in Europe at the time. And racing as a pro, I went right into my season ranked third on the pro circuit in Europe. And proud to say I was the only American still today to make a living or earn a living as a professional track racer year round, when today you still have to race the road or at least supplemental income in order to earn a living. So it was kind of fun. I think this piece here you show me, I guess I'm racing against a couple of Belgians, the Belgian professional champion and the Belgian amateur champion. Fun kind of time. Races like this was round robins. The six-day circuit for me was something where you start racing between 8 and 9 at night and you finish around 3 in the morning. But my life was living by night. It was cold and snowy outside and warm and smoky inside because 90% of the Europe smoked cigarettes. And it didn't matter because I stayed paid anyway, something that you would never read about in USA Today. And this is just something that was just my life of making a living on the track and living around the world. If you look here, I had first generation zip wheels. That was a pretty good dollar under the table that no one ever knew, but I helped their innovation of what you see on zip wheels today. Really happy to be part of something like that. Racing the sprints in Kirin. Wow, isn't that a cool picture of me? First generation. Remember those days, Connie? I was so proud to be on Connie's team. Connie Finney, that was great. I think she hated me. I was always intimidated by her because like she was the cat's meow, but I had the same jersey and I was on the same team, so I was cool. Something that you're watching right now is Midnight Kirin. That was the toughest time of my life because, I mean, literally it was sponsored by Binder Optics, which is your Pearle Vision here in America, but every night at the 6 days at midnight, you have the Kirin and you gotta see this. It was just one of those things that we did, but I had a lot of fun. I think this particular race that you're probably watching was something like out of Bordeaux at the time. Whoa, I lost track, but I still look good. Things like that, let's turn the sound off Regis because we don't need that. But being one of the only Americans to do TV shows like Regis and Kathy, twice, Regis wasn't there 1 year, I showed up instead of me not showing up. Brian Gumbel and his sports thing that he has on HBO now, that was kind of an honor. And many other TV shows that I had an opportunity to appear on. And again, I like to contribute that to people like Mark Gorski, who helped us get the sponsorship through ProServe and to keep me busy throughout my career. I'm gonna talk a little bit more about the six-day circuit. Whoa, they showing those legs again? Those Pistons, you'll get to see a little of those in action in a little bit. Those are in blue right now. That was like a French thing back then. But, you know, racing the six-day circuit in Europe, living by night, I tell you what, it was good money. Something like that paid anywhere from $5 to $1,000 a night, 6 nights a week. Grenoble was one of our hardest cities, but at the same time, being so naive in the sport, but so good about what I did, Grenoble was something where I hung out with the Dalai Lama for a week and didn't know who he was. And he knew that, because I asked him to move his car, because he was just parked in my spot. I show up to the President Hotel with a brand new BMW 745. You can only see in the magazines, and I had one. But Grenoble was hard racing, and after doing my sponsorship with Moet Champagne at 5 in the morning, you take off in your car and you go to Geneva, Switzerland, and you do a one night. And then you have to drive through the night at 150 miles an hour to get to Munich before traffic. And then you sleep at the track before you can turn into your, before you can check into your hotel. But that was the life and times of me racing. Gaining UCI points, and these are things that people never knew that still exist today and is going on. I just got a picture from Chris Gutowski on email. He was just at Grenoble 6 Day a week ago, and they're still doing sprints, and they're still having fun. And ironically, table 4 that I'm sitting at tonight was my sponsorship table when I raced the 6 Days. So if you sat at table 4, it was usually my sponsorship table that I honored. Usually my sponsors of the 6 Day races sat at table 4. Which is still, you drink, you eat, you dance, and occasionally you watch some races. But pretty cool stuff you see that you don't see in today's world, and maybe someday Todd will be announcing this on the USA Network, on the US Network with NBC. Again, that was pretty big money. It was good. It was a hard life, but that's what I did by night. And ironically, once again, Mark Gorski allowed me into his home come some spring day when I was training for the Kirin in Japan. That was something else that was pretty different. And this is what you see. This is real Kirin in Japan. This is how it is. And this is just something that you can see. Can you turn up the sound so we get a little flavor? This is a real lead out from Nelson. Check out those pistons. Talk about veils over the top. Leading out Claudio Godinelli and Michael Hubner, my two best buddies. So that was something that we did in Japan. That was good money. That was a true lead out. We all got paid the same. And what you don't know is in Japan is per mutual betting. And this is an event where it's like horse racing in America and the Kentucky Derby, where we did this every 4 days in Japan in a different city. And again, how I got here, how we got here, I got a chance to see the world on two wheels, racing my bicycle all the way from Harlem, New York City. And it was a great honor. But stuff like this in Japan is just, this was the honor for me because turning professional was the true goal to be able to go to the Worlds, gain a ranking at the World Championships to get an invitation. You just don't show up to Japan and say you want to race. You have to be invited. And this is the best of the best of the best. So I was one of two Americans, thanks to someone like Gibby Hatton, to help pave the way for me to go to Japan. And there hasn't been any other Americans to go there and race that I know of, but to my knowledge. But learning the culture in Japan and being able to speak the language and travel, and everyone's looking at Nelson as, where do we go, what do we do? My nickname became Tokyo Nelly. If you didn't hang out with Tokyo Nelly, you wasn't living right. We play dress up, you get on a bullet train, you go race, you kick ass, you count your money on the train on the way back, and you spend a night in Tokyo, you spend a little bit of money, and the next day you go to the bank and deposit it. Not until you spend $1,000 before you go home, though. First stop was the Hard Rock Cafe, Tokyo. But just to keep with the flow, you know, once again, you know, from Tokyo to around the world, Erevan, where we spent many nights, to here at the Hall of Fame, you know. Phyllis, I'm only going on 50 next year. I can't wait to be like 93, one of those old dudes with a nice bike at the coffee shop. Yeah, I just so look forward to it because you look great. It's just been an honor to be part of Black History, especially every February. It's just been an honor, and an honor to be here at the USA Bicycle Hall of Fame. I tell you, I'm trying to hold back the tears and be all cool. In true life, I would throw in some eye drops real quick and fake some tears, because that's what we do. That's what I did on my retirement tour. He says, man, you're really emotional. It's like, yeah, pass me the eye drops. But for the guy that actually was able to bid for the ride in the tour of California next year, Andrew, I like to say, if I can roll with Ray, and if Ray is in Com 1 and I can roll in Com 2, you want to roll with me in Com 2, because I'm always with the break. The official hanging out the sunroof, and you too. And we're going to roll real good 10 minutes up the road until they get caught. Then you won't see anything until I take you to the finish line. You can watch the rest on TV. But in my closing remarks, and again, it was a fine honor, and it is a great honor to be here, and I'm a little stuttering right now. I just want to give thanks to my girlfriend, Kelly, who's here tonight. She's helped me move on with spiritually and mentally, and to just graduate from cycling and to move on here. And everyone doesn't know, but right from here at the Hall of Fame, I head to Las Vegas, Nevada, to the MGM Grand Hotel to be a personal concierge at their Skyloft building. So for $8,000 for 3 nights a weekend, you can come stay with me and I'll hook you up. Trying to keep up here with the flow. But once again, thanks for having me, and I just want to leave with this final remark, which is, I woke up with this saying, and you can wake up tomorrow as well, and how we got here is, remember these words, details, details, details. Things to do, things to get done. Don't bore anyone with the details, just get it done. Thank you.
Nelson Vales. The guy just uttered the words, I asked the Dalai Lama to move his car. I laughed through his entire speech. It's the most insane thing I can ever imagine. Oh, the world's greatest smile, man. He could light up the world with that smile. And another awesome person joining the troop of four tonight. Number 120, 1, 2, 3, and 4, going into our Hall of Fame. We end every one of our Hall of Fame dinners with a keynote address, and I'm very, 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 very proud tonight to have up here a lady that I not only admire as an athlete, but respect as a human being. We know what she's done. We know about the 4 world championships, and we know about the Olympic gold in Los Angeles, the first woman to ever race in the Olympic Games in cycling on the road, and she won it. She raced when she was, I think, 12 years old, or actually she had 12 national championships and raced when she was just a kid on speed skates in Lake Placid as well. But it was in 1977 when she was at the Redzinger Bicycle Classic, and Mo Siegel, then the president of the Celestial Seasonings Tea Company, asked me to become involved in that process, and I had a chance to see my very first bike race. I was the PR director for the event. And it was in 77, and Connie Carpenter was the women's star, and Wayne Stettwin was the men's star. And they both won the race that year. It is that year, at that time, at that moment, that I fell in love with bicycle racing for all the real reasons. The color and the speed, the danger of the sport, the youth, the competitiveness, everything that it had to offer. Because I didn't come from a cycling background. I wasn't one of those guys that had been on bikes since I was a young kid. This was a remarkable thing for me because part of the reason why I'm here tonight and why I did what I did in the sport or any contributions that I've made is because of Connie Carpenter. It directly relates back to me seeing this individual on a bike competing. And I loved watching her and giving her trouble by bringing in the world's best women and every year watching her go to battle with them and in many cases win. She became the national spokesperson for multiple sclerosis because of her mother having MS, and then now involved with the Davis Finney Foundation, her husband Davis Finney. They met at the Coors Bicycle Classics. So it's another extraordinary connection that I have with them and one that I'm certainly proud of. The Connie Carpenter Finney bike camps, the Carpenter Finney bike camps that took place over the years, and the fact that she was such through all of this, the matriarch and the rudder as well as for her family, raising two kids. And this is the very cool thing about this whole thing, as Connie comes up, is 19 years ago, she was inducted into this Hall of Fame. It was 1990, 19 years ago. She has a son who was born that year, little, tiny, cute, 7-pound, 8-ounce Taylor, who was born to Connie and Davis that year. They met at the bike race. We proudly call him a race baby because he was a product of the Coors Classic. That was 19 years ago. He is 19 now. She was either pregnant or had just had Taylor when she accepted the award for coming into the Hall of Fame. I could not be prouder and happier to have her here tonight as the keynote speaker to all of us to tell us a little bit about those days and about her family and about her life. A lady I love so much, Connie Carpenter Finney.
Number 155, Connie Carpenter. They're around the last turn, and here they come. It's going to be a battle right up near the front. Now let's cheer these riders on. It looks like it's going to be a real sprint up to the line. Terry Peterson is up there. Connie Carpenter, Mary Jane Rhea. We're all in the lead. It looks like Connie Carpenter. Connie Carpenter has got it. Connie Carpenter, Terry Peterson, Mary Jane Rhea.
The winner of all three races of the Red Center Classic.
This is it. This is the last 500 meters of the race. People are going to come to a standstill. About 200-300 meters to go, the sprint should start.
Here they come. Over 2 hours. Almost 50 miles. There was a slower, lagging group that just passed the finish line right now. They've nearly been lapped.
Here come the motorcycles across the start-finish line. Here goes the sprint. It's all come down to this after 50 miles.
There are the Americans third and fourth.
Notice Cannon of Italy is taking the lead. I think she feels she doesn't have a sprint sufficient enough to win, so she's going to lead out the sprint and hopefully drop the other riders. Rebecca Twigg and Connie Carpenter are in the best position possible.
Well, where's Longo?
Twigg and Carpenter.
Cannon leading out the sprint.
Heading down the home straightaway. And less than 100 yards to go now.
All over the road.
Rebecca Twigg has got the lead.
She's got the lead on
Carpenter.
The inside. Carpenter on the outside.
Oh, Carpenter.
I think Carpenter got her. Carpenter just did get her at the very end. With Twigg second, the Americans wind up 1-2. And in a race of almost 50 miles, they win it by maybe the width of a bicycle tire.
Incredible race. Oh, what a close finish.
It looked like Twigg was going to take it. I believe it was Carpenter who got it at the very, very end with Twigg second. Schumacher finished third, so they were perfectly positioned coming down the straightaway, running in third and fourth position. And so in the first ever women's road cycling race, here it is again now.
Connie throws her bike. She takes the necessary lead to take the race. Notice she threw the bike. I think the positions of the bodies were about the same position.
The husband of Davis Finney, who will be out on the track in an hour and 15 minutes. Well, that's one gold on the mantle in Boulder for Connie Carpenter Finney. The first ever women's road cycling race. The first ever women's cycling competition, period.
That was close. My heart is going about 200. I was afraid I wasn't going to win that time. Actually, the best thing about watching highlights of yourself and the guys can attest, your sprinters, you know which ones you won and which ones you lost. And even when you come across the line and it's that close, I actually knew I won the race, but I also thought I'd won by about that much. And it wasn't until later when I saw the video on the news and I was like, ooh. Michael, you did make a mistake. In 1990, when I was inducted into the Hall of Fame, I was 8 months pregnant with Taylor, and I didn't make the journey here. This is actually my first visit to the Hall of Fame induction ceremony, so I'm happy to be here. Thank you. But a lot's been said and written about my son, Taylor, our son, Taylor, and I'm going to talk a little bit about him tonight because I think one of the things about cycling, and it's been said a few times tonight, is that, we're all in some rather large, sometimes dysfunctional, sometimes wonderful, and always forgiving family, right? So, Nelson, I'm sorry if I intimidated you back in the day. But it was your smile I just had to stay away from. And Mark Gorski is still as handsome as ever. And Sheila Young-Akowitz is still one of my best friends ever. And so we're a great family, and we've been through a lot together. 1984, in a lot of ways, seems like yesterday. And again, it seems like it never really happened, like it was a dream. The thing I remember most, I get that question a lot, what do you remember about 1984? And unlike Phyllis, my memory is not that good. Don't get me wrong, I admire that. She knew which gear she was riding in because I can't remember which gears I rode in yesterday, much less a few years ago. But what I really remember in 1984, because it was the first time that the women were included in the Olympic Games. And it was the first time that women would race in the road race at the Olympic Games on the first day of competition. So it was July 29th, 1984, when we didn't know what to expect. It was, as most cycling road races are, a free event. So we hoped a few people would turn up. What we didn't know that morning when we drove in to race, and I think our race was about 9:30 in the morning, that there would be several hundred thousand people waiting for us, and that most of them would be cheering for us. You have to understand that in the 7 years previous of my career, I started bike racing in 1976, and when I was, of course, only 12 years old, as Michael said, we always had our world championships in Europe, and it was a very foreign event. You'd show up to these races. Of course, we also race in South America too, but you'd show up and you really didn't have too many people cheering for you. You were lucky if the coaches were cheering for you. So this is really unusual experience, and I really remember that. I remember rolling in to the Olympic course in Mission Viejo and looking at the people that were actually waking up because they'd camped out on the course and were in sleeping bags. And they were all Americans, and they had American flags, and they had signs with our names on it. And, to me, I remember more about that moment than I do about the race itself. But what I really remember about July 29th, 1984, is the fact that when the race was over and I knew I'd won, the one thing I really wanted to do was phone home. 1984, we didn't have cell phones. So I had to go looking for a telephone. And they were waiting for some of the other racers to finish, so I thought, well, I'd go over to the ABC scaffolding along by the finish line and try to go see if they had a phone over there, and I had to climb up into the announcer's booth and grab the phone. And what I really wanted to do was phone home, because my mother had multiple sclerosis and couldn't make the trip to Los Angeles. I had a few brothers and a lot of friends out in the crowd somewhere. But it felt really impersonal because my family wasn't right there, so I just really wanted to get on the phone and call home. So I went up into the scaffolding, I grabbed the phone, you know, from Al Michaels or whoever, and I said, I need to call home. And I dialed up my parents' home in Madison, Wisconsin, and the phone rang and rang and rang. And I thought two things. One, my father's had a heart attack because the race was too close. Or they forgot. And there was no possible explanation that they weren't just sitting right by the phone, waiting for me to call. It rang and rang and rang. And when finally a very breathless woman answered the phone, my mother, oh, hello, dear. Out of breath. My mother was never out of breath. I said, Mother, where were you? She said, oh, we were out in the backyard shooting off fireworks. And I think the beauty for me of that moment and the thing that sustains me through my life is really that kind of spirit. And I really got that from my mom, that she was disappointed not to be there with me in Los Angeles, but she was really happy to be home. And she was ready. She was also prepared. Those are the details. She was prepared. She had the fireworks, she had the bottle rockets, and she was shooting them off in the backyard. But you know, a lot's changed since 1984 in cycling. Not only the equipment, but also who we are as individuals in the sport and who we are as people in the world. You can't do much that's under the radar anymore, right? So I want to show a slide of, you can show the first one, yeah. This is the birth of cycling, right? Some people think it was July 27th, 1990, when Taylor was born. Most people in my family think that. But really, this is one of the logos for our bike camp, and I love that because no place is cycling greater than in Italy, and so to see the Madonna celebrated in this way is blasphemy, but you gotta love it. I've got another slide there of, this slide here is particularly what I'd like to talk to you a little bit about tonight. 100,000 miles. When Taylor started bike racing, no one was more surprised than Davis and myself. And you may think that it was automatic, that when you have two children born into a family with two prominent cyclists, that naturally your children will follow you, and naturally our children were really not following us. And it really didn't bother us because, you know, we were having fun, and Taylor was really excited about playing soccer and really could see himself being a professional soccer player until we moved to Italy and he realized just how mediocre he was at soccer. And the whole time we actually did move to Italy after Davis was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease because we had the opportunity really to not only improve on our language skills, which are molto bene, right, Massimo? Sempre. But also to allow our children to live in a foreign culture and to learn the language and, just kind of give us a break as a family. So we lived in Italy, and as the world would have it, as the fates would have it, we lived 100 meters from the current women's world champion in cycling, Tatiana Guderzo, who won the Worlds this year in Mendrisio, literally lived 100 meters from us and was born about 2 weeks after I won the Olympics in 1984. You know, there's always somebody coming up to replace you. You just didn't know they were going to be right down the street from you. But I knew her because her brother played soccer with Taylor. And to me, it's that sort of family that, you know, it doesn't spiral in, it spirals out sometime. And that's the beauty of cycling. It's not only that you can get on your bike and ride to Lake Geneva and take the train home. Traveling with six men, Phyllis, I want to hear about that. I mean, we need to talk. But you know, the beauty really of cycling is this expansive family that we have. And so, Taylor, while we lived in Italy, we rode our bikes and we conducted our bike camps and we had some fun, but he never expressed any interest in cycling until one day at the Tour de France with Davis, he met Axel Merckx. Axel Merckx, of course, is the son of Eddie Merckx. He's about Taylor's height, which is well over 6'3", and into the plus 6'4s. And just a really elegant, funny, charismatic individual. And I think it was the first cyclist Taylor met that he looked at in the eye and said, I could be like that. And again, coming to full circle, Eddie Merckx was one of the sponsors of Davis's team when they were racing in the early years, the pioneer years of 7-Eleven, going to the Tour de France and being the first American team to race at the Tour. So, you know, the family, we kind of stick together, and we've sort of roved across the planet. But if you look at this slide of our 100,000 miles, what you find is it starts in Aguascalientes, Mexico, when Taylor won, very surprisingly, the Junior World Championships for cycling, and finished in Beijing last summer. And the journey was as unpredictable as anyone could imagine a sporting experience to be, because basically I had this kid, 17 years old, senior in high school, who decided, along with his parents' support, that he should try track cycling. And it was really thanks to Sheila's brother, Roger, who said, anytime you want to come down to the track in LA, I'd love to introduce Taylor to track cycling. And he had told me that several times, and it was before Taylor had won the Junior World Championship. So after he won the Junior Worlds, and we said, you know, we'd like to bring Taylor out to ride the track. He's like, well, yeah. And put a lot of time into really kind of honing Taylor's track skills and bringing him up to speed quite quickly. So Taylor won, as a junior, he won the senior nationals in 2007. And things had changed a lot. You know, it used to be when we qualified for the Olympics in 84, every country got a few spots on the starting line at the Olympic Games. And now you have to qualify through a very convoluted series of World Cup points and other points, and get points from doing this, from doing that, and basically he had no points, and it was halfway through the track season, and he's looking at it saying, I want to make the Olympic team in Beijing, and I'm looking up the points and what he would need to do, and it was statistically, mathematically impossible for him to do that. And so I looked at him, and I remember sitting across the table. It's kind of like that Gary Larson cartoon where the humans are talking to the dog. I mean, I'm explaining to him what's going on, and he's just hearing blah 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 Olympics, blah 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 Olympics, and he's like, yeah, I could do that. I'm like, well, you really can't do that because you have to go and to all these World Cups, and you're in high school, and there's no guarantee, and there's really no funding, and all he heard was, Mom, we need to go for it. And I said, well, if you want to go for it, I'll go for it. And thankfully, you know, we have Steve McCauley here from the USA Cycling Development Foundation, and we got a really great grant from them to, really basically a private sponsor to help Taylor achieve his goal by going to all these World Cups, going to LA regularly, trying to get through high school. And what happened was we went to Sydney, we went to Beijing, we went to Copenhagen, we went to Manchester. We had to go all around the world just to get the points to qualify, which he did do. And you know, I have to say, I went with him every step of the way. And most parents don't get the opportunity to spend that kind of time with their teenager. And it's been good. It's been really good, and it's been trying, and it's been satisfying, and it's been way more rewarding than anything I've ever done in my career. Because as an athlete, when you do well,
tell me about Taylor. What did you say?
Whoa. Nope. You got to wait on that one. With as an athlete, you don't really get to brag as much about yourself. But when it's your child, you can stand up in front of a room full of people and talk about him. But you know, he really hasn't let us down, and it's been a lot of fun. And
tell me about Taylor.
Hold on to that, because here's this is Eddie B. How many people in the room actually know who Eddie B. is? So Eddie B. was our national coach in 1984, and he defected from Poland in 1976, and he had been a cyclist and a cycling coach, and came into our culture and tried to help us to become better cyclists. And a lot of us chafed under Eddie B's direction. He was, after all, Eastern European. But last winter, and I'll jump ahead a little bit, Taylor won the world championships. He's the youngest elite professional world champion ever. At 18 years of age, he won the 4,000-meter pursuit in Poland, and Eddie B was there. And Michael took some offense to this little statement, but let's see if you can understand what Eddie says here. We'll run this little clip.
Tell me about Taylor. What did you say?
I say what? Both you. He is better than both you guys together.
So, translation. He's better than both of you guys together. That's Eddie B. And, you know, you have to understand, he's lived in this country for 40 years, and he still sounds like that. And I actually, you know, used to think it was kind of funny when you meet foreigners and they lived here all this time and they still sound the same. And then I lived in Italy for a couple years and I realized I'm just like that. I make all the same mistakes. I never learn. But anyway, so we went to Poland last year. Taylor had a big letdown in Beijing, actually. I think it was, way too much pressure. And it was also like being a kid in a candy store when you arrive in Beijing and there you are. And there's video games till all hours of the night. And there's this huge cafeteria. And there's 10,000 athletes in the village. It's just too much going on for a just barely 18-year-old kid. But he kind of went after the world championships last year as redemption. And track cycling now has moved into, it's basically a winter sport. The season starts now and it runs through the world championships. So we went to Warsaw for the world championships last year in a beautiful facility. And Taylor won. And Eddie B was there. And it seemed like everything had kind of come full circle because there was Eddie B and there was Taylor and, you know, it was this big family thing, and Taylor wins, and he gets off his bike, and Eddie comes over, and he says to me, Connie, Taylor must do change gear. Eat this, do that, train like this, do this. I said, Eddie, he just won. He said, I know, but I am coach. And so in a lot of ways, some things really never change. I want to talk a little bit about, you know, Taylor rides the track, and it's part of what he does. But he also wants to be a road rider, and one of his big ambitions has been to perform well at the Paris-Roubaix. And he rode the Paris-Roubaix race. You may not know this, but there is a shortened version for juniors, which he did 2 years ago as a junior, and he crashed 3 times, was passed by the team vehicle, who didn't know he'd crashed because he was off in a gutter somewhere, had a flat tire, tried to ride his bike with a flat tire because he was in the breakaway, actually, of the lead group of about 30 riders, rode about another few miles to the next cobble stretch on a flat tire, was taken in by a family of picnicking French people. This was the same day as the pro race, who gave him the best-tasting liter of water he'd ever drunk in his life. And he lay on the side of the road waiting as SAG vehicle after SAG vehicle went by full of riders and wouldn't pick him up. Finally, he gets in one of the last SAG vehicles, which they didn't have a seat, so they put him in the way back. You know, and he's cut up, and he's bleeding, and he's covered in grime, and the driver of the SAG vehicle hands him a bottle of whiskey. He's 16 years old. And he, to his credit, declined it. But he came into the finish line that year in the SEG bus, which is, you know, not where you want to be when you're trying to be a competitor. And very disappointed, but eager, you know, to be there on the big stage. And so this year, he went to Roubaix and had the chance to race again. The under 23 racers, which is the category that Taylor's really in now, is another category just sort of before he makes it to the leap to the Pro Tour level. So he went there this year with moderate expectations. That race is about 40 kilometers or 25 miles shorter than the pro version. Anybody who doesn't know the Paris-Roubaix race, you know they have several brutal segments of cobblestones that they go across. It's usually extremely windy. It's just a brutal race, and it's extremely, extremely challenging to stay up in the front. And we knew Taylor had been really gearing for this race, but we didn't know what our expectations were for him, and of course we knew he wanted to do well. But in the middle of the night, a text message came through. We were in Boulder, and Davis had a fundraising ride that day in Boulder, and we got a text message at about 3 in the morning, which of course we didn't pick up until 7 in the morning, and it said, Dad, I'm getting a cold. I don't know if I should race. What should I do? And of course Davis had missed it, and the race had already started, so we didn't know what had transpired. We just assumed he was in the race, and we went on our ride with the Davis Finney Foundation in Boulder. And I was riding next to Steve Johnson, who's president of USA Cycling, and I was sort of making this excuse that Taylor was getting a cold, and we didn't anticipate that he was going to have a good ride, when all of a sudden the phone rang, and Davis was, you know, was riding, pulls the phone out, and he's like, what? He did what? This is the beauty of the cell phone nation. It was Axel Merckx on the other end of the phone telling us that Taylor had, in fact, won the Paris-Roubaix. And on that day, in the end of May this year. So, you know, there was quite a lot of whoops coming out of the group, and an incredible moment of pride, I think, especially from Davis, that Taylor had accomplished this, especially on a day where he didn't feel well. And it was compounded by the fact that Eddie Merckx was sitting in the follow car with Axel. There was a lot of pressure. But it was a beautiful moment, and for us to be part of it, to receive a phone call like that, like the phone call that I placed to my mom, you know, I think there'll be more. There's good calls, there's bad calls, but it's been a great journey so far, and it's kind of a rebirth of the cycling community for us, the racing community, the embrace of some very good friends that have really helped Taylor out and really helped him in his journey. And he's just starting off. He's 19 years old, and it's really been fun. And I hope that some of you, when you follow cycling, will kind of remember and just think about it. I'm going to finish my talk here with a little slideshow. And it's really a little bit about the family and the spirit of it and the joy of it, because in everything that we do, the thing about cycling, whether it's BMX, whether it's track cycling, whether it's road cycling, whether it's recreational cycling, cycling somehow, some way makes your life more interesting. Makes your life more challenging. It makes you appreciate everything, from food to the water you drink and to the dinners and the friendships that you have. And that's what my take home is from cycling. It's not so much the races, it's not so much the victories, though there are many people in this room who have accomplished a great deal. It's more really, truly about the family and about who we are as individuals as we go through this journey. I did bring for you, for the Hall of Fame, from Davis, my husband Davis, who, this town is named after my husband. Maybe he named this town. Anyway, he is donating to the Hall of Fame a Coors Classic jersey that he wore in 1988 when he won the final edition of the Coors Classic as it stood then. And as when I mentioned that to Sheila Young and I showed her the, Sheila Young Akowitz, I'm sorry, I showed her the jersey, she said, "That's our car." Because in 1988, when Davis won the Coors Classic, he was given a BMW convertible, which he gave to Jim Akowitz, and which they still proudly drive and maintain. It's a beautiful thing. So so this is a gift for the Hall of Fame. My gift will be forthcoming. I don't know what that'll be, Don. We'll come up with something. I want to thank Dawn for her hard work, and I want to leave you with a little family slideshow.
Thank you.
two more things. One, the two shots of Taylor with Lance, that was 1 year apart. 1 year they were like the same height, and the next year Taylor was... Anyway, I really need to make a note that Taylor has a jersey, a signed jersey in the back on the silent auction. And I don't think there's too much money down on that. I think we could compete with Hank Aaron. Come on. It's back in the corner. And huge thanks to Lance Armstrong, too, for what he's done for Taylor and the under 23 guys on that team. And thanks to you guys. Good night.
Connie Carpenter Finney. Not always to be so modest that she really didn't mention that one day when Lance Armstrong was watching Taylor and they met finally and went down to Austin and spent some time down there, that Lance just kind of arbitrarily on the spot made the decision that he needed to form a team around Taylor Finney, and he picked the telephone up and he called the guys at Trek and he said, I need a few mil, and they made the decision literally on the telephone call. He turned to him and said, you're on my team, and the rest is going to be an amazing history. Boy, I tell you what, this is when the family becomes a dynasty. And it starts right there. So there we are. All four of our inductees are in officially. We're going to close the vault on another great year. I want to thank Neil Michael, who did a tremendous job over here. He's been helping pull things together. All the production here tonight did a great job. Axiom is his company. And of course, Sutter Davis Hospital, they were our official presenter for our event here tonight. And I want to thank UC Davis and Freeborn Hall. This is a great place for this function. I am so glad that we are here. Everything looks awesome. Great job. Thank you, UC Davis. Amgen and, of course, AEG and Andrew Messick, we're going to see you coming up here on, I think it's May 17th for stage two of the race that's going to start here. Thank you guys for your support and for offering the opportunity for someone, two people actually, to take a great, great trip in the race caravan this year. PG&E, and I want to thank Royal Guest, who provided all of our hotel accommodations for this weekend. Fat Tire Beer was on duty tonight from Fort Collins, Colorado, New Belgium, and Peloton Sellers for their support tonight at the induction ceremony. Right afterwards, I want to remind all the inductees, old and new, the ones that are in and the ones just installed today, to please come up to the stage for a very, very quick photograph. We'll try to be prompt about that right after our finish here tonight. We're going to wait 15 minutes to close the silent auction, and then after that, we'll see how far the Hank Aaron ball goes. So you guys over at this table, get yourselves back there. Just wait for a second. We'll let you go in a minute. I want to remind you that, once again, that iTunes U, right up there on the top of iTunes, is where you're going to be able to watch this event again, or for people who are unable to attend. And there were a lot, certainly from around the United States, that were touched by this event in some way who could not be here tonight. We'll let you know when that's going to be on there, and you will be able to look back at it in its entirety. We're going to settle up for the silent auction afterwards, just out in back, I guess out in the hall. I want to remind you that if you want more information on all of this, it is usbhof.com. That's the go-to to get more information about this whole thing. And thank you to Don Weilung for having me here tonight. This was just a great, great treat for me to be a part of this whole event, and I thank you all very much. The hall is over at 3rd and B, and will be open occasionally. They're just getting everything fully pulled together, and thanks to the board and everybody here who's been in support of that program for a long, long time. This has just been a great and glorious evening, and thank you very much again, Don, for everything. So a big hand now for our inductees tonight, Richard Courtwright, Phyllis Harmon, Clayton John, and Nelson, I ask the Dalai Lama to move his car veils. I wish you all a great rest of the year. We'll see you next year. We'll see you back here for the Tour of California on May 17th. Take care. Be safe.